is not a guide video by any means, because it's just too simple. It's too simple. So all you need So today I am very excited to be making some music on the beautiful Commodore Amiga, and I was inspired to do this video based on a conversation I had with the Amiga multi-talented programmer, musician, and artist Talin, who brought you such games as Fairy Tale Adventure and a personal favorite of mine, Discovery. And one that is often not looked at these days, but a very powerful piece of software, Musix-X, which is what we are going to be using today to make some music. I believe most of the music we are familiar with when it comes to the Amiga, and the music that is still made today with the Amiga when people do demos these days, I believe they are using tracking software, tracker software I think it's called. And I don't know if you guys have ever witnessed one of these programs, but if you do, maybe you'll understand when I say that the music that comes out of the Amiga these days, it feels more like a programmer has been responsible for it than an actual musician or, you know, amateur musician or whatever. The heart isn't really there, because they're not really playing it. It's a tracker program is just a bunch of numbers and stuff, and it's utter gibberish to me when I look at it. I've never been able to understand how the hell to use a tracking program. I'm sure they've got some minds on them, but, well, they can produce some good sounds. What I'm going to give you today is going to be different, because I'm going to hook it up to an actual keyboard. Now, people don't realize that the Amiga was capable of this. Look at the Atari ST, a lot of credit for having been built with MIDI connectors on it. The Amiga did not have built-in MIDI connectors. Nevertheless, it was designed from the beginning to have MIDI support. All you needed was an adapter, and I have such an adapter here. There were more expensive options, there were less expensive options when it came to hooking up a keyboard to the Amiga. What they usually call them is a MIDI interface device or processing unit or something. I'm going to show you what a real MIDI processing unit is. What you see here is the Roland MIDI processing unit, an MPU IBC-T. I have this for my Roland MT32 to connect it to my DOS PC. This sucker is weighty, made of metal, and believe it or not, inside of this is a computer. It's got a processor in it. This is a MIDI processing unit. This will not work on the Amiga, I've tried it. which is unfortunate, because this has a processor. Like, this could take resources away from the Amiga, and it would probably be nice to have it. This cost a hell of a lot of money back in the day. It cost a lot of money when I got it. A few years ago, it cost a lot of money. on the Amiga, it came built with support for MIDI. All you needed was an adapter. Unfortunately, some companies made devices that they passed off like this. Like it was actually a device, and all it was a piece of plastic that housed the adapting, you know, that housed the adapters that crossed the wires, you know, that lets you connect the two, because the Amiga, unlike the PC, it could just do it. But some of those processing units could cost $200, at least $100. They go up a lot more than that, and they don't offer you anything. All it is a piece of plastic that just crosses wires. But there were cheaper options back in the day for adapting your keyboard to get into the Amiga. You know, it could be as cheap as, you know, $50 even, maybe even less than that. basically, it's just crossing wires. That's all. That's all my adapter is. On one end, we have a serial port connection. The other end, we have, you know, 9-pin DIN connections to go into a keyboard. A standard affair. All you need to do to use a keyboard on the Amiga is to match up the wires and connect it to the Amiga. You don't need a MIDI processing unit. And to this day, those things will go for over $100. And the only thing those get you over this method is you might have like a pass-through. I'll probably show a couple pictures of an example of what those units look like. All they will do is offer a MIDI throughput. And this one offers, you know, an in and out. It has two outs though, so you can also put it to another device besides, you know, the Roland MT32. That's all the Amiga adapters would give you, but inside the box itself, there's nothing to it. All it does, it just adapts the stuff. And all you need is an adapter like this. This is called the KA12B. I bought it, $40 or something. Online, it was from Poland. It took a while to get here, but it got here. And fairly good quality build, but you can make this yourself for a hell of a lot cheaper. Because, if you got a series, you know, you can... It's just switching the wires up. That's all you gotta do. You can look it up, you can do it yourself if you want to. We're gonna just dive right in, a beginner's look, as it were. I'm gonna later do like proper reviews for some of the software, but I felt it was necessary to just dive straight in and look towards the intuitiveness of playing music, the Amiga, because that's how you get interested. That's how you dive. You want to dive deeper because, you know, you sniff around a little bit and you feel your way through it, and it's very important to be able to do that. And if you can't do that, then you're never going to be interested in diving deeper. Tracking programs, you just look at it and it's a bunch of gibberish. How are you going to get into that? If the moment you look at it and you can't deal with it, you got to read huge manuals. Now the program we're going to be playing music with today, Musix-X by Talin, that one came with a huge, huge manual, so there's a lot to it, but at the same time, it's intuitive, and that is very important to be able to dive in and, you know, whet your appetite a little bit before you, go in a little deeper. Again, this is a video that's going to be for Talin, and I had an extraordinarily great opportunity. It just came out of nowhere, really. I wouldn't call it an interview, but it's just a back and forth, and then I got some very, very awesome information. Just a conversation we had, and it was a nice conversation. I'm going to do some, videos concerning that. I'm going to, tell you all about the conversation we had, and I'm going to, take a look at some of this software, like Musix-X. They inspired me to want to make music on the Amiga, just to try it out. And I didn't want to do it half-assed. I didn't just, okay, here I am playing music, look what can be done. No, I'm going to show you guys just how much I instantly fell in love with making music on the Amiga, and guess what? I have an entire album's worth of material for you guys to listen to, should you want to. I'm going to release the video at the very same time. Click on the link if you want to, but it's going to be 13 tracks, all on the Amiga, 45 minutes or so, completely 100% Amiga music written by me. You guys got these toys, you got the Amiga these days, and most of you are just playing the games on it, which I understand, they're fun, but I'm telling you all, there is so much more enjoyment to be had out of the Amiga than you're giving it credit for, because you're just playing the games. And the Amiga, believe it or not, I know a lot of the Europeans don't believe this, it definitely was a thing in America, but it went to the computer hobbyist market, guys with deep pockets, and it sold more than you guys are willing to admit, and the people that bought it had more money to buy other things with, so it was an important market, and things like Musix-X, software that, would have gone for over $200 brand new back in the day. This is stuff that people in America would buy. It's very important to understand that, to realize it, and to see the fun you can have, and I'm going to show you the fun that you can have by having fun myself. So I hope you guys will stay tuned for the upcoming videos on Talin, and I hope you get some enjoyment out of watching me make some music, having a blast with it. I hope you guys will go out and try it yourselves, because you can have so much fun, and I'm going to show you, I feel like I made some music that's very different from anything else you've heard from me. Not to say that my music is better in any way, I'm not saying that, but I'm saying it's different because there's a lot of heart that goes into actually playing music with your hands as opposed to programming it. It's a very different process. I think even the people that are programming and that are using the tracking programs could benefit from trying this out, and it's not that hard to do. It's this $40 part for me, but you can build it yourself for a lot cheaper. And I'm telling you, I have not had more fun out of any retro system ever. I've never had more fun with any of my computers, ever! Sounds that are capable from this system are so amazing because it's sample-based. Because they actually take a recording and they put it into the Amiga, and that's what you're dealing with. You're adjusting the recording, it was such a enlightening experience for me playing music with this, with the Amiga. It makes you understand both the limitations of the system as well as the amazing things it was capable of. The Amiga, you can't have that much going on at once, otherwise notes start cutting out and stuff. But so there's a limiting factor there, but it causes you to think a little differently, and maybe you'll produce something special that way. But at the same time, you listen to games, and maybe the games sound good, but maybe they don't sound quite, right or whatever, and then you start understanding, well, maybe they didn't have enough memory, maybe they didn't have enough disk space to store the songs, because it's capable of so much. It's capable of sounding exactly like a piano, exactly like a guitar. So many things that this thing that could have been in games, but probably the reason it wasn't in games was just because of the storage factor. And by no means is this a guide video, because it's just too simple of a procedure. There's no need for a guide on playing music with the Amiga. All you need is the adapter. A serial port to 9-pin DIN connector, 5-pin, I think I said 9 earlier, it's just standard MIDI keyboard stuff. So you have a Casio keyboard over here. On the keyboard end, you stick your things in there, okay? It's got a handy little label here, so black is in and red is out. And the way the MIDI always works, it's the opposite on the other end. Hook them up and it's as simple as that, and then we hook it up to the serial port on the Amiga. So here we have the back of the Amiga. It's really as simple as finding the serial port here. And hooking up your device to it. You want the label that says in, out, that'll be the right side for you. And it will fit in. I want to talk about this cable that you see here too. Because this might be a benefit to the people making some music on the Amiga. I have a special adapter kind of cable here. Now these cables go to the speakers that I hear every day, for the Amiga. Normally you'd have the speakers hooked up like that, but I have this special cable here. This cable is, I got it from Radio Shack, but I don't know the technical name for it, but it will fit into the Amiga, but it also has connections of itself, so you can also hook it up to the speakers. So you got your sound going to the speakers, but at the same time, you have this, and it goes to its own end. okay? And from this end, you could connect it to, you know, some kind of capture device like this. And connect it there. And it has a special USB cable, and you can connect it to a computer. That's how you could get it into the modern realm and record the audio, so you're not just dealing with the music on the Amiga itself. You can actually... And this is how I got the music over to the modern systems, was via the use of a capture device. And this cable will help you guys if you want to go that route. It's just so you don't have to be unplugging and plugging in cables all the time. This will just keep it at the ready for you, should you need it. Our purposes today with the keyboard. I'll get up to the keyboard. Now, I will say that this cable itself is not very long. When it's hooked up to the back of the Amiga here, it can pretty much allow the keyboard to go in a 90 degree angle from where you're sitting. So you're looking at the Amiga here, and right to the side is the keyboard you're playing. That's all the length it has, so you might want to get an adapter to plug in on the keyboard and to extend it a little. Turn your keyboard on. Hit the buttons necessary to give control over the external source. See the lights are moving, but no sound is going on there. And then get yourself some kind of a sequencing program. And I told you earlier we're going to be using Musix-X for this demonstration, but there are many other ones, like Bars and Pipes here, and even Musix-X, there was a Musix-X 2. We are using Musix-X, which I have installed onto my hard drive, but it'll work from a floppy as well. So let's load up Musix-X. Turn right next to me. Goes there. And you notice that even though gave control of the keyboard over the computer, now we can again, you can hear music coming out of the keyboard. Talin showed off Musix-X in an episode of the Computer Chronicles, which I will, I guess, I'm not going to link it because I hear that Stuart Chaffee, the host of Computer Chronicles, I hear that he put all his videos up on archive.org or something, but people have been downloading them from there and then uploading them to YouTube, and I don't believe he supports that. They're for free on download.org, but he does not support people showing them on YouTube. Therefore, I will link to the archive.org episode so you can see Talin showing off Musix-X on the Computer Chronicles. That was great. It was a great episode there. You'll want to see it. But the thing about his, but when he did it, he was really focusing on using the Amiga as a musical device to store the music kind of thing, and to play it on the keyboard itself. He wasn't actually playing music using the Amiga, with the Amiga's built-in sound capabilities. He wasn't using that. He was using it to record. So, for example, I'm going to delete this. I don't like the metronomes. But it's really as simple as this home screen here. All we gotta do is hit record. That's really as simple as it is. That's really all there is to it on this. We hit record, and we don't even have to do anything. We can just press a button and it will start recording. It'll give you a little 3-second delay before it actually starts recording, and then we can do stuff. Okay, and then we hit stop, and go back to begin. We can press play, and it will come back through the keyboard. Wait, sorry. Sorry guys, first before you hit play, you have to hit store. There's a button here called store. Hit store, it'll save it into memory for you there, and it will default to the keyboard. We hit play now, and it should play through the keyboard. There you go. It even lights up for us on this model keyboard, as long as it's on channel 1. That's exactly what we just played. And yeah, you could. The Amiga is very capable of storing many, many sequences and playing them back through your keyboard. The keyboard should have 16 built-in channels, as mine does, although mine's a little peculiar in that I can't actually switch the channels from the keyboard itself, which makes which means we have to use a little bit of a workaround in Musix-X to get that working properly. Because my keyboard itself does not allow me to manually select the channels, but it does indeed have 16 channels. It's weird, but we are not focusing on getting the Amiga to play stuff. I will show you an example of the keyboard playing stuff, because I believe Talin has built in to Musix-X a couple sequences which perhaps some of you are familiar with. To begin, and all of them are set to play externally, although yeah, he's got some of them turned off. He built all of them in there together. But does this sound familiar? And also, people, notice the tempo that this is played in. Hit play. Sound familiar? That is the opening theme to Fairy Tale Adventure. To hear that playing through a piano keyboard, very cool to hear that. And but notice the tempo though. Everybody online has it playing in PAL mode, and it's a hell of a lot slower in PAL mode. But this is actually the correct tempo of the song. Talin had it set up to where he turned off the other tracks, but no. In order to hear the other tracks, like the main theme during the game, you'd turn off the title theme, and you'd click here to turn on the main theme. So we go to beginning again and we hit play, and this should play the main theme. And it's so cool to hear that. Like that. Very cool to hear it on the piano, because, well, I imagine that's how he heard it. He would have been playing this I believe probably a Roland keyboard or something like that. It may have been that in his mind that's what he heard, and then he just had to deal with what the Amiga did. But I love it. Just listen to the speed of that, and then compare it to the videos you see online. No more PAL mode, guys. But we have other ones like the nighttime theme. We can switch off and go to the encounter theme. He can really make some catchy, good tunes, I gotta say. And I'm just, you know, just for the sake of it, I'm going to go through them all. Just a little bit. Just give you a taste of them all. Definitely check out A Fairy Tale Adventure. It's one of the best games of all time. And lastly, we have the finale. The thing about the music that he has there, again, it's all expected to go externally. It's meant to be played on your keyboard he didn't actually store the samples used in the game itself, so we can't hear it as heard in the game here. Because Musix-X did not seem to come with too many samples. So where that would have been extraordinarily useful for the musician back in the day to have, this is basically a little recording studio, and you're just using the computer as the tape device, really, the recording device. So you don't have to hook it up to a 16-track reel-to-reel. You have the computer to hold that data for you, but then you can always have it played back through the keyboard. And you could then hook up the keyboard to the various, tape players and record it that way. You would record the audio from the keyboard. That seems to be the way this was mostly set up. But again, that's not what we're after, because in modern day, you can do that very easily with your own PC. What we are after is the unique sound of the Amiga itself, because that's what we're into. Because believe it or not, this is an amazing thing. The sound is amazing on the Amiga, and it's its own thing. So you listen to it, and you can have something special, something that no other keyboard, no other musical software is going to give you. It's the Amiga's thing. That is what we are after, so that is what I'm going to show you. In order to get the Amiga to start to play music itself, we have to go to the Amiga samples. Go to Amiga samples, and the only thing that comes there is the metronome. But we go to file, we go to load sample, IFF. Now, Musix-X does not come with too many samples. I got a clean guitar, I got a drum, two drums, a mellow synth, and the metronome. That's all the samples Musix-X itself comes with, but we'll put it in there. Oops. Okay, again, and it'll play through the keyboard. That's what it's going to want to play through. But we can go to, I believe, set filters, and go to internal. It's a very cool sound out of the Amiga. But you'll notice it's not even a 2-octave range there that it has. And all the rest of the keys are useless to us. That's some of the samples, that's what you gotta deal with. We can tune them differently. You definitely risk. You definitely risk making it sound awful, though, when you play with the tuning, but you might have to play with the tuning with some of these samples, like what we're going to show you now, because Musix-X does not come with that many samples from Talin, but it contains more samples, Deluxe Music 2. Here we have some samples, and we have lots of samples for Deluxe Music, accordions, banjos, bass, harmonica, clarinet, pianos, lots of stuff. Let's start with the vibes. Vibraphone. Now, I will say, the stuff that comes with Deluxe Music, maybe if I play it in Deluxe Music, it'll sound different, but when you play it through Musix-X, it's only really usable at the very bottom of the keyboard there. And up here, it sounds just terrible, so you'll have to detune it. You'll have to take it down a lot. Hopefully you get it to sound okay, though. vibraphone, but I had to detune it a lot in order to get it to sound good for me. Those are the strings. What else we got? Strat synth. Some of these, the volume is not up to snuff with some of them, so you can actually drag this here to make the volume go up a little. Change the audio filter there. I really like that sound, the Strat synth. It sounds more like a guitar than a synth, really. There is the audio filter. You can engage the audio filter on the Amiga. With the audio filter engaged, or you can disable it. I can't get enough of the Amiga 1985 technology. It sounds like a piano. And then you have the very, very expensive MT32, which I own, and it can't do a piano to save its life. And of course, the dominant form of music back in the day for computers was FM synthesis via Adlib and Sound Blaster. And good luck. Good luck getting anything to sound realistic on those devices, but here you have 1985, and you know what? It sounds like a piano! And you're only limited by the sample that you get, so there are better pianos than that. You can have one that sounds even better, you can have one that sounds worse. You're only limited by the recording, you know, the sample quality that you're using. So we can have the acoustic piano. We can go back to sequencer here. And now we can record some stuff and we can hear it through the actual Amiga. Let the clock run there and now we should be able to go. Stop, we hit store, and it'll default to playing back to the piano again. But we can turn that off by, there's a button. There is something that says out there. We click on that and go to internal. It once was at external. Now we hit play. And it will play through the speakers. I think because I can't switch channels internally on the keyboard itself, I have to use a little workaround on Musix-X. Because it'll default everything to recording on channel 1, apparently. At least I haven't figured it out yet. My workaround, and I don't know if I can change it. I don't think I can change it the way it is now. I think I'm going to have to delete that track. My workaround has been to go to Set Filters and remap it. Okay, so here are the 16 channels available through MIDI. My workaround has been to, click it. It'll default to channel 1 from this keyboard. So what I've been doing is remapping channel 1 to channel 2, 3, and 4, and so on. Remap it to channel 4, and now we don't hear anything. We go to channel 1. So we go to channel 4, we don't hear anything. Then we go to Amiga Samples, we go to channel 4. And we load a sample onto channel 4. Let's use the electric piano. This one has a very nice electric piano. I have to say, I really like the electric piano sample here. A little loud, so we'll move the volume down a little. We go to the sequencer and we'll hit record now, and it'll automatically send it to channel 4 via the electric piano. Now we hit play. But now, what if we want to add some more stuff? Okay, so we go back to Set Filters, and instead of channel 4, we hit channel 3. Go to Amiga Samples. Go to channel 3 now, and we'll load a sample. And we'll load the bass. Not quite sure how this is going to turn out, but, let's give it a go. We'll hit record. Should give us a few seconds here. Well, let's try to pick out our first few notes here. Oh, it already stopped. It started before. I'm going to turn off this one track here because I just don't want it playing at the moment. This one playing. Alright, so. Hit record. Go. Gonna count back by 2 seconds, and it should start soon. So we're gonna let it play here. Store that in, and you hit play again. It should do what we just played. Starting now, I think. You come with the Amiga, and this is what made me understand some of the limitations of the Amiga, is that the more you're doing, the more you're storing, the more you're hoping to play with the internal music, the more it can't quite keep up with it. So let us load one of my performances to show you an example of all of this. Here we have a composition by me, and you'll notice I have two of them playing internally and I have one playing externally, because if we play them all, the Amiga can't quite handle it, at least the way I play, because I want to do a lot of things with my hands. The more notes you're trying to get play out of the Amiga itself, it'll start dropping notes. It's not a problem if you're sending all of it back to the piano, but the Amiga itself, here is just one track playing. I believe that is an electric piano. I made it play externally without telling it to turn off there, but that was my basic rhythm electric piano that I was doing for the song. But then I have other tracks. Let's turn on just the second channel here and play that for you guys. This is a guitar of some sort there, a distortion guitar of some sort, I think. Now, that's, just them separately, but if we turn them both on at the same time, the guitar should come in about here, I think. You notice that it's cutting out the guitar? Not all of it, but it's definitely, you can tell, it's not what you just heard a minute ago. It's wanting to cut it all out because it's playing both the piano and the guitar, and I'm just playing too many notes at the same time, and it's cutting out. But we could. Here we play both through the piano. It has no problem sending it outward, so it does record it, but it can't do it internally. It has no problem sending it to the keyboard. And we have a third track as well. So we'll enter right here. That is how I would record the track. I would send the other tracks I was done with to the piano, then I would listen to what I was hearing through the Amiga. But the way I recorded them for you guys to hear in my video is one channel at a time, pretty much. I play one channel at a time, send it off to the computer, the PC, and then I rearrange them on the PC to fit together, because unfortunately, when you play the way I play with just, you know, when you're playing with both your hands at the same time and you're adding different channels, you're adding all these other instruments, the Amiga can't quite cope with it. I think a lot of people got around this issue back in the day. This is how you learn about some of the limitations, but you also understand how awesome the Amiga was and the people behind the Amiga making the music, because they would get around these issues, okay? So I'm playing all these hands at the same time, I'm having rhythm and all this other stuff, and it's cutting the music out. So when you listen really closely to a lot of the Amiga music, you'll start to understand how simple, technically, a lot of it is, and they're just playing. They're just playing one note at a time. Downloaded samples from AmiaNet. AmiaNet is your friend. They've got a lot of instrument samples there. What do you notice there? I'm only pressing one button, but you're hearing more than one note. That's a bunch of chords. They chose to record for the sample. They chose to record, you know, somebody playing a chord on the piano. So that is what you're getting. I think you'll notice when you start listening to a lot of the stuff closely that they use these tricks. So if you want to play a whole bunch of instruments at once, well, record one instrument playing a bunch of notes at the same time. You want to hear the Amiga do the Commodore 64? You'll get some of these samples and you'll just play around with them, and you'll get a song out of just playing around with the notes. It's kind of cool. Now, it isn't just this screen we're dealing with, okay? This is the main screen, and it's a very simple, you know, it's like a tape recorder, pretty much. You record, you stop, you begin, you can cue some spots, set the cue, and you pause it, you can play it, you can record from it. But that's not all we have. We got the edit screen, and we'll see them represented by bars of notes there. We can hit play. I believe it just hits one channel at a time, so no matter how many channels you have set, it'll just play one channel at a time when you use the bar scenes. But here we have a lot of control, though. I mean, we can actually move the notes around, I believe. Here's, we can move it. Say we don't like this note there. We can actually change it. We like that sound better. Instead of there, we can change the note there. And it'll actually move it for you. We messed up. We hit a key we didn't want to hit. We can hit remove. We have a whole block. We really don't like this section of music there. Select it all. And we can delete it. Now check out this sweet, sweet electric guitar sound here. That's it's amazing. I cannot. I am utterly in love with the sounds I can get out of this machine, this oval. I'm amazed. Besides the bar editor here, where we can see the individual notes and mess around with them. Me play, but we also have the event editor, where it does look an awful lot like a tracker program, doesn't it? But it'll go through all the events there. Isn't that so cool? I'll probably get faster once I get to this section. Yep, look at it go! Probably use this a lot like a tracker program and mess with it and get it to repeat things and such and such. I have no idea how to look at. I can see it has the notes and has the keys and, you know, has the volumes and, yeah, whatever. It's a little too much for me. But we do not have musical notations, though. That's the only thing this one is lacking. I enjoy having the notations, but playing around with this, it's not needed, honestly. It is not needed the way this thing is set up. It's so damn good. It's just a tape player, pretty much. Record! Hit record, play your stuff, play it back. It's an awesome little thing. This is an example of the heart that you can get out of this. This cannot be done by a tracker. It cannot be done by a tracker. It's emotion. There's feeling there. There's not lyrics, obviously. I can't put lyrics. It'd take up a hell of a lot of space on this sucker to put voice samples in there. But you're getting emotion there. That's what your hands can offer that a tracking program cannot. It's something very different from what you're used to hearing on the Amiga, but it sounds amazing. And it sounds different, and I definitely encourage everybody, have some fun with your Amiga. If you got a real Amiga, definitely pick up one of these adapters, hook it up to your Amiga, and have some fun. You're going to have a lot of fun, I guarantee it. Even if you're not that well-versed of a musician, I mean, this is set up so anybody can mess with it. You're gonna have fun just playing one note at a time, I swear to you. You're gonna have a lot of fun if you give this one a try. I think a lot of people out there, once you hear your own creations play through this system that you all love, I think you're gonna get so much enjoyment out of it. I've had more enjoyment out of this than anything, period. Out of any of my systems, okay? I bought an MT32 for my PC to play the DOS games with the best sound possible. That was a hell of an investment. I really enjoyed that. But I spent, $40 on an adapter to hook up a keyboard to the Amiga, and it's 1,000 times more enjoyable than the MT32, I'm telling you. I love it. It is so amazing. Really, I really enjoy this emotion coming out of the Amigas. Really love it. Musix-X version 1.0, May 17th, 1989. And he was using the Talin call sign back then from 1989. That's pretty cool. And, yeah. I really recommend everybody get one of these cables, hook up a keyboard. Do your Amiga and make some music with it. You're gonna have a lot of fun, I guarantee it. And a lot of sequencing software available for that. Musix-X is a great one to start with because it's so intuitive and simple, but there's a lot in there. This thing came with a manual this big. So there's a lot more to this program. I'm gonna do a separate video for Musix-X. Stay tuned for that video. Stay tuned for the video where I'm going to talk about Talin and my conversation with him. I hope you'll listen to my album, my Amiga album. 13 tracks, 45 minutes or so. Listen to that if you want to. Listen to some of these songs. I really had a blast. I just hammered through them. I never made music so quick in my life. It was amazing. It was just a treat. I hope you all enjoyed it. Talk to you later. Bye.